Hey everyone, a very good morning to all of you. Myself, Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. So let's begin this video. But before that, let me inform you all that you can download the PDF of this session via the Telegram channel of ours. The link of the channel is in description below. So here is our first question. What is the name of the quarterly newsletter of Indian Cybercrime Coordination Center recently launched by Union Home Secretary Ajay Bhalla? So here guys, the right answer is option C, Cyber Prabha. Now this is basically a quarterly newsletter of Indian Cyber Crime Coordination Center, and the purpose of this newsletter is to give information about the activities of this I4C center, also to create awareness about the cyber crime. Now this quarterly newsletter will be released in two quarters, from April to June 2021 and July to September 2021. Now guys, there can be a tricky question framed out of this entire news, and that question is, Indian Cyber Crime Coordination Center is administered by which ministry? So here the right answer is Ministry of Home Affairs. However, on the face of it, it appears that Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology would be the godfather of this center, but it is not so. The ground reality is that it is under the administration of Ministry of Home Affairs. So do remember this point. Now on that note, I would like to ask that in which city is the center located, which is the national center, I should say, because this is only one Indian Cybercrime Coordination Center. So where is it located? Mention it in the comment section below. Now apart from the launch of this quarterly newsletter, a set of manuals were also released that tell about how the cyber crimes can be prevented and cyber hygiene can be implemented across rural areas, in industrial bodies and among the general public. Now cyber hygiene means the good practices in cyber sphere. Moving on to the next question, which program has recently been launched by the Ministry of Ayush to serve healthy diet to ensure a healthy life? So here you have the five options: Poshtik Ahar, Swasthya Ahar, Ayush Ahar, Siddha Aadhar, Sampoorn Ahar. So the right answer is option C, Ayush Ahar. This Ayush Ahar initiative, basically, first of all, you need to understand that right now it has been launched on a pilot basis, and it has been launched at the canteen of the Ministry of Ayush Bhavan, okay, so which is named as Ayush Bhavan in New Delhi. So at its canteen only, this Ayush Ahar project has been launched. Now, a tricky question that can be framed out of this news is the ingredients or the dishes that are included in this Ayush Ahar, because the number of dishes that has been mentioned in PIB is very limited. Therefore, they can ask a question out of it. For example, this healthy diet includes kokum drink, gajar ka halwa, bhajani vada and vegetable poha. So only four dishes are mentioned here. So obviously they can ask a question from you on the dishes also. Okay, so do prepare them. Next is, which university has established the first of its kind Kalpana Chawla Center for Research in Space Science and Technology? So here the right answer is Chandigarh University. Now let me tell you that this center is the first of its kind center in the North India. Okay, so do remember, first such center in the North India. But overall, this Kalpana Chawla Center for Research in Space Science and Technology is one that is established in Chandigarh University. Now let's go into the details of this center. So Defense Minister Rajnath Singh has inaugurated this center in Chandigarh University. Okay, so from the name itself, it is evident that the center will work for conducting research in the space science and technology. Now apart from this, the Union Minister also launched the Chandigarh University's Defense Scholarship Scheme. Now under this scheme, basically the children of the defense personnel will get scholarship in this Chandigarh University. Okay, now the worth of this entire scholarship scheme is rupees 10 crores. Next is that this Kalpana Chawla Center for Research in Space Science and Technology would be the ground control station for the Chandigarh University's student satellite. So Chandigarh University's students are preparing a satellite, and this center, this Kalpana Chawla Center for Research in Space Science and Technology, will act as a ground control station for the Chandigarh University students' satellite. Now with the launch of this CUSAT satellite, the state of Punjab would become the first border state to have its own satellite in the space. Okay, so that is also important that you need to know. Now this CUSAT is an in-house developed nano satellite. In-house means the indigenously developed nano satellite designed by the students of Chandigarh. So that's all about this entire news. Let's move on to the next question. When was the B9 group formed? So here the right answer is 2015. So let me give you some information regarding the background of this B9 group. First of all, this is the Bucharest 9 group. Okay. Now it was formed in 2015 after the in the wake of the 2014 annexation of the Crimean Peninsula by Russia. Okay, so I hope that you are already aware of this entire scenario. Because of this annexation, Russia was kicked out of the G8 grouping as well, which later became as the G7 group that we know now. Okay, So because of this Crimean annexation by Russia, in the wake of this situation, the Bucharest 9 group was formed and it includes only 9 members. All of them are European countries. Now let's have a look at the news and the member countries of this B9 group. So first let me tell you the members. So Poland, Bulgaria, Romania, Slovakia, Estonia, Lithuania, Latvia, Hungary and Czech Republic. So all of these are European countries and all of them are the members of the B9 group, which was formed after the Russia's annexation of the Crimean Peninsula. Okay, now what is the news recently? Why is it in the news? So recently, Lithuania, basically I hope that you all are aware of the China-Taiwan tussle. Okay, so China continuously puts pressure on other countries to not recognize Taiwan as a separate nation. And in that background, Lithuania recently announced, basically allowed Taiwan to open its embassy-like office on the soil of Lithuania. Okay, so if any region or we can say any nation is given this facility of opening an embassy, this clearly indicates that Lithuania is somewhere recognizing Taiwan as a separate nation. So this angered China. Now USA and the Bucharest 9 group members, all of them have supported this step of Lithuania. So that was the news because of which this Bucharest 9 group was in the news. I hope that now it is clear. Now let me show you the Lithuania and Taiwan's location. So guys, this is Lithuania, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania. All of these three countries are together known as the Baltic countries. Okay, because Baltic Sea surround these countries. Now this is Taiwan. Okay. So this is Lithuania, this is Taiwan. I hope that the locations are now clear. Next question is, which of the following company has launched India's first exchange traded fund based on the auto and auto ancillary sectors? So we have ICICI Prudential Mutual Fund, Axis Multicap Fund, Motilal Oswal M50 ETF, both A and B, both B and C. So here guys, the right answer is option A. ICICI Prudential Mutual Fund is the basically mutual fund that has launched this first ever ETF, which is based on the auto and auto ancillary sectors. Okay, so basically along with this ICICI Prudential Fund, Nippon Mutual Fund has also launched this India's first ETF on auto and auto ancillary sectors. Now basically this ETF will track the performance of the automobile companies, and on the basis of the performance of the automobile companies, it is going to give the benefit to the investors who have invested in the ETF. That is the entire news all about. Now companies like Maruti Suzuki, Tata Motors, Mahindra and Mahindra, Bajaj Auto and so, these companies have a very high weightage on this auto index. Nippon India Mutual Fund has also announced the launch of Nippon India Nifty Auto ETF, which is India's first auto sector ETF, and ICICI Prudential Life's Auto ETF is known as ICICI Prudential Nifty Auto ETF. So that was all about this fourth question. Now let's move on to the next question. Actually, that was the fifth question. Okay, what is the maximum limit for insurers for issuing surety bonds? So guys, here the right answer is option A, 500 crores is the maximum limit for insurers to write any kind of surety bonds. Now what are the surety bonds? They are basically signed for giving surety, giving guarantee against the contracts. For example, A has signed a contract with B and A is in doubt that B is not going to fulfill its obligations. Therefore, it needs a third party guarantor. So it goes to an insurer and signs a surety bond. Okay, writes a surety bond that in case of a default on the part of B, then the insurer is going to pay the entire amount to A. Okay, so it is going to compensate A. This is the surety bond and this is particularly for contracts. Okay, now the maximum limit an insurer can sign for this surety bond is rupees 500 crores. That is the entire news all about. Okay, so recently the IRDAI, that is the regulatory body in India, Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority of India, has released the IRDAI Surety Insurance Contracts Guidelines 2022. Now, under these guidelines, it is mentioned that the insurance company is bound by a cap of 10% to write a surety bond, okay, which is again limited to a maximum limit of rupees 500 crores. Okay, so in any circumstances, this amount cannot be exceeded by any insurance company. However, the 10% is, even if the 10% limit is much more than the 500 crores limit, but still the maximum cap is rupees 500 crores. So whichever is lower, okay. Guys, here the the questions for the session end. Now it's the time for the GK Factory section. So I hope that you all must have a question regarding the ETF, because surety bond I have explained, and I hope that you all have understood what a surety bond is in actuality. But what is an ETF exactly? Many times we come across terms like ETF, terms like AIF, fund of funds, NFO, etc., etc. But we tend to ignore it because we have a lot of syllabus to cover. Okay, but if we understand these concepts, then it become more and more easy and enjoyable also at the same time. So today the topic that I'm going to discuss with you is the ETF. What is an ETF exactly? So ETF stands for exchange traded fund. Okay, so it is basically an investment option. First of all, that's the very primary feature of this ETF. Second feature is that it has the features of both a stock as well as a mutual fund. Okay, now you must be thinking that, is it an amalgamation of both? Are we going to have a stock like facility as well as the mutual fund like benefit from investing in the ETF? Stay with that question. You will get the answer of this question by the end of this GK Factory section. Okay, so first of all, the ETFs can only be bought through the exchanges like BSE and NSE. Therefore, here stocks and ETFs have a similarity, because in case of mutual funds, they can be bought at a asset management company or mutual fund company. Okay, next, ETFs collect money from the investors and invest in an index in a sector or a commodity. Okay, now it is a very similar feature to a mutual fund. Okay, because in stock we directly give money to the company and we have only one asset here. But in ETF, the ETF managers collect money from the investors and invest in the index or in the sector or in the commodity. For example, an ETF is tracking gold. Okay, the price of gold will decide the price of the ETF and will decide the return for you guys if you have invested in the ETF of the gold. Okay, so this is how it is an indirect investment in gold. Okay, after the investment, the ETF manager or administrator allots the net asset value, means units, in proportion to the investment to investors. So this is a very basic point. I hope that you have understood it. Next is that the value or the return of each and every net asset value or the entire ETF is decided by the value of the underlying commodity. Okay, so as I told you that you have invested in the ETF and the ETF has invested in the gold. So when the gold's value changes, ETF's value will also change and your return value will also change, because ETF has allocated NAV to you in proportion to your investment. This is nothing but, you can say, a unit that has been given to you, which is again determined by the price of the gold. Okay. Next is, as and when the value of that underlying asset changes, the return of the ETF is also changed. Okay. Now, what are the similarities between the shares and the ETF? By now, you must have understood what an ETF is, but what are the similarities between the shares and the ETF? ETFs resemble shares a lot, as the corpus of the ETF cannot be changed once it has been launched. Okay, in shares, since at the time of the launch of the shares, like in IPO or FPO, the number of shares that are announced by the company that we are going to launch this much shares in the IPO, they cannot be increased or decreased after the announcement or after the launch. Similar is the case with ETF. The entire corpus of the ETF, for example, 1,000 crore rupee ETF, so the amount cannot be changed after the launch of that ETF scheme. Okay. Both the ETFs and the shares are only bought and sold via the exchanges like BSE, NSE, and the value of shares and ETFs vary on real-time basis, as the ETF is itself based on another asset's value. Okay. Now, you need to understand the difference between the ETF as well as the mutual funds as well. Okay. So, it looks like the mutual fund because of certain similarities, but it is not so. Now, I will tell you why. In case of shares and the ETF, we have understood why are they not same, because ETF certainly does not give money directly to the company as in the case of shares. Okay, so that's the basic major difference between ETF and shares. But if it does not give money to the company directly and invest in the stocks of the company indirectly, as we have seen by tracking any index, then how is it different from a mutual fund? That's the case that you need to focus upon right now. Okay, so like mutual funds, ETF also gather funds from the investors and invest in other assets, but there are few differences between these two. First one is that mutual funds are bought from the asset management companies, whereas the ETFs can be bought from the exchanges only. Okay, which is also a similarity between the ETFs and the shares. Next is, investors can anytime get his or her money back by selling the mutual fund with the help of AMC. But in case of ETFs, the selling takes place at the exchange only. And whenever you want to sell your shares, you need a buyer, a ready-made buyer, to buy your ETF units also, as in the case of shares. Okay. Therefore, in case of low demand or market slump, ETF may not get sold at the desired price. So that's the disadvantage of ETFs. Now guys, the last topic that you need to understand here from ETF is ETF fund of funds, because I hope that you have seen the earlier sessions of Daily Current Affairs where I discussed what a fund of fund is. So I'm not going to tell you this again in detail, but a fund of fund, if I want to explain it briefly, so a fund of fund is a fund that invests in another fund. Okay, so here the example is this: Invesco India's. Okay, now let me give you the example here directly. Now basically this ETF fund of fund is, let's understand this from this example. So here the investors in India have invested in the Invesco India's ETF, okay, ETF fund of funds. Okay, now this fund of fund is based on this ETF again. Therefore, it is a fund of fund, ETF fund of fund, because this fund's value is again dependent on another fund. So this Invesco UCITS, which is an Ireland-based ETF, is basically an exchange traded fund that tracks the performance of the blockchain companies. Okay, so the performance of the blockchain companies will determine the rate of return of this ETF, and the performance of this ETF will determine the rate of return for this ETF fund of funds and the rate of return for the investors in India. Now guys, do remember this thing, that it was the first of its kind ETF fund of funds based on global blockchain companies that was launched in India. So again, this is a very recent example, a very recent news also. So I hope that ETFs are now clear to you. And on this note, I am going to say goodbye to you all. And if you have understood anything in this video, then do not forget to subscribe to the channel, hit the bell notification. Thank you so much guys for watching the video.